Let's pray together. Thank you, God, for your mercy and goodness. Thank you again, God, for this wonderful day of life we have as a gift from you to come and sing your praises. We thank you for the great songs of faith that help us express our heart's desire. Thank you, Lord, for these songs of faith that help us to express our love and our appreciation for you and what you've done for us supremely in Jesus Christ, who gave his life for us on the cross, who rose again and who's alive today and promises to live within every person who will invite him to do so. Thank you, God, for your presence with us this morning. We can sense the presence of your Spirit working in us and through us and around us today, God. For some of us, this has been a great week, a week of success and victory. For some, this has been a week of trial and discouragement. But God, we put all the stuff of life in your hands. We know that you're with us in the good times and the bad times. And we put all of it, Lord, in your hands today, trusting and knowing that you're our Heavenly Father and you care for us and love us very much. And so, God, we have the strength and the faith to come before you in honesty and authenticity and simply lay our lives before you. Search us, God. Search our hearts. Try us, O Lord, this morning. And if there's some way in us that needs to be corrected, we pray that you would correct us. If we have places within us that are damaged, we pray for your healing. God, where we need to be encouraged, encourage us today. Thank you, Lord, for your precious presence with us. We invite you, Holy Spirit, to do here in our hour of worship together, within our lives, within our families, within your church, what it is you want to do. Thank you, God. We offer our lives to your good care and keeping. We're grateful, God. We pray with gratitude and in the name of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. And you may be seated. Well, this morning, we begin what I hope will be a great 12-week journey together as we look together at affirming our faith, the ancient faith of Christianity through the Apostles' Creed. We're going to take 12 weeks to look together at this ancient creed, what it teaches us, what it says, what it doesn't say, and how it still guides us centuries later. What can we learn from the ancient church? What can we learn from our faith? How does the Holy Spirit still work in God's church today? So this morning, I want to invite you to look at the screen. Some of you already have this memorized, but let's share together this morning. Christian, what do you believe? I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, His only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day He rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence He shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Thank you. Amen. Well, what do you believe? That's a good question for anyone, especially sitting in a church house. What do you believe? And I guess if we were to go through this morning and ask all 300 or so of us in the room this morning what it is you believe, we might get 300 answers that were slightly different here and there, and that's okay. As God's church together, we are the people of God, and we express the faith of the Christian church together. We've already talked about for several weeks the idea that the church is kind of like a mighty oak tree. Its roots are in Jesus Christ. That's where we get our nourishment. That's our foundation. The trunk of the tree is the church, God's church all over the world, and the branches of that tree represent the traditions, perhaps, or the denominations, if you will. And all of them are a little bit different in the way they express their faith. Some are a little bit different in some of their beliefs, and though we share many core beliefs together, but taken on a whole, that oak tree, that giant oak, is a beautiful thing to behold. And it provides a home, a spiritual home, for all of God's people. The church is like a giant oak tree. And to be sure that most traditions, most denominations, if you will, have sort of a parameter of what they believe and sort of acceptable beliefs and acts within that particular tradition, that particular denomination. I guess some of our most conservative or fundamentalist traditions that almost looks like a line, because everybody sort of is expected to believe almost the exact same thing. And then there's some traditions where the boundaries are so far apart you wonder where they are, if they have any at all. And then there's others of us, like the United Methodist Church, where there's some parameters here or there, perhaps, and we're trying to figure out exactly where those parameters are. But you and I don't have to believe exactly the same thing in order to love each other and care for one another and serve Christ and worship God together. But this morning, we're looking at some foundational beliefs. Beliefs that we believe give us our very identity as God's people, as Christians. Let me ask you a question. What do you believe? And how have you come to believe it? Have you ever asked that about your core beliefs? Have you formed your core beliefs by reading the Word, perhaps by looking at the teachings of our tradition or Christians who have gone before us? Do we form our core beliefs, you know, by watching television or by listening to the news or the latest song on the radio? What is it? How is it that you've come to believe what it is that you believe? Our beliefs are very important. Our core beliefs make us, in many ways, who we are. For example, if you believe that there is a God that loves you, a God that created you, a God that knows you by name, a God that loves you and is with you every day of your life, that will change how you get up in the morning, friends, right? Some of us have come to believe and know that God. It changes everything. It changes your future. It changes how you look at life. It changes how you perceive life. On the other hand, if you believe in God, but you believe that God is one who's just upon a cloud with a big club waiting to whack you if you do something wrong, that will also affect the way you live your life and the way you think about life and the way you perceive life. I told the 8:30 crowd this morning that some of the meanest people I've known were people who believed in God. But the God they believed in was this mean guy who lived on a cloud and was just waiting to zap you with a bolt of lightning when you screwed up, right? Anybody ever believed in that God before? Yeah, sure. And Wesley believed in that kind of God at one time before he was freed from that and learned to know this God of love and grace, the one who gave his life for us on the cross. When you come to know God as one who loves you and cares for you, it changes. You can't help it. It changes your life and it changes the way you look at things in life. Our core beliefs make us who we are. Some people believe that they're, in other gods. Some people believe in many gods. You know, gods are, I don't know if you've noticed this in our culture, but gods and goddesses are a dime a dozen. There's a lot of them out there. You're going to hear all kinds of things. That's not new. Read the pages of the New Testament. 2,000 years ago, there was a whole plethora of gods and goddesses that people believed in. Some people believe in other gods. Some people believe in many gods. Some people believe there's no God, that we're out here sort of sailing around on our own. That's not something I want to believe. That we're just on our own, completely alone in the universe, that there is no God. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth. Say that with me. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth. Say it again. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth. Our church, our tradition, has given us a great kind of a framework for helping us understand what we believe and why we believe it. It's called the Wesleyan Quadrilateral. I think we have it up here on the next screen. John Wesley didn't come up with this per se. It was a guy named Albert Outler, a Methodist scholar, that did so. But it's based on the teachings of our particular tradition and our particular church, our branch of the tree. We've said that the only way we can know anything about God, or about life for that matter, is if God chooses to reveal that to us. And God has used across history four chief ways to reveal God's will and God's way for human beings. First is reason. God will use this brain of ours, right? All truth is God's truth. Do you believe that? Oh, maybe. Do you believe that? Let me say it one more time. All truth is God's truth. You believe that? I believe that. I can worship God with my mind because God is not anti-reason. You don't have to check your brain at the door. God's the one who gave you a brain. God's got the highest IQ there is, right? right? We believe that God can reveal to us through our mind. That's why we as United Methodists believe in education. We believe you need to learn all you can learn. Tradition. We believe that other people have gone before us and that God has taught them many things that they can pass on to us, many valuable things. I remember when I was a teenager, I wanted to do everything myself. And I don't know, maybe it's just me. I mean, as a young man sometimes, I just wanted to do things my way. I didn't care what other people did. I didn't care what other people were doing. I wanted to do it my way. My wife would tell you sometimes I'm still that way. But as a kid, I could see it myself now looking back. But my father would say things like this. He'd say, "You don't have to reinvent the wheel." And I didn't know what he meant the first couple. And then I came to understand. What he's saying is there are people who have learned a lot that have come before you, and you don't have to do it the hard way. You can learn from them. Friends, we have 2,000 years of church history. Some of the most brilliant thinkers, some of the most inspired spirits ever to walk the planet have gone before us and have given us a tradition, a Christian tradition, including the Apostles' Creed, and we can learn from them, and it can be valuable for us and even guide our future. Experience. We believe in experience. We believe that the Holy Spirit can speak to each of us individually and personally. John Wesley believed that. I believe that. You probably believe that. All the time I hear folks in our congregation say things like, "Well, I think God is telling me to so-and-so." Or, "I feel as if God is leading me in this direction." Anyone ever felt that way before? Not that you've heard God speaking to your ear audibly, but you've sensed the nugging, the tugging, the nudging and the tugging of God's Holy Spirit. We call that Christian experience. And it's a valid thing. Well, I pray that the Holy Spirit speaks to every one of us in the church in some way this morning. And then finally, of course, is Scripture. This is a unique book of many books. Written by dozens of people across the course of at least 1,000 years, it contains not only the wisdom of humanity, it contains, I believe, the Word of God to guide us and lead us. It has proven true for generations who've come before us. We have to interpret it. We have to take it in context. We don't want it to say only what we want it to say, right? Sometimes we do, but we shouldn't do it that way. We need to open our hearts and our spirits and our minds to its inspiration, because God will use the Scripture to guide our lives and to guide our church. That's called the Wesley Quadrilateral. The Apostles' Creed that we'll be looking at over the next 12 weeks represents ancient Christian beliefs expressed across the centuries. It's been around for a long time. Some of you have studied the Apostles' Creed. I know there's a couple people that are really interested in the Apostles' Creed. You know more about its history than I do. I can tell you this, that it was first mentioned as an actual authoritative creed in 390 AD. That's 1,600 years ago. But it was written probably before that, and it came together even before that. Don't misunderstand. The Apostles' Creed is not something that one or two people came together, a pope or some Methodist preacher or something, and came down and just wrote down, and this is what we're going to believe from now on. That's not how it worked. The Apostles' Creed is an expression of what the church had already come to believe and accept about the faith and about who God is and who Christ is and who the Holy Spirit is and who we are as God's children. And all that came together quite early in the history of the church, at least by 390 AD. You know, in the church, we always have to keep a balance and sort of a tension between the old and the new, don't we? New information is really important. And when we get new information, again, God, all truth is God's truth. So when we have new information, that should inform and shape some new beliefs that we have, perhaps. It's important to grow and change. My beliefs about God and about life are different today than they were 30 years ago when I started ministry. I think that's natural, because we grow and we learn and we have new knowledge. And it's important to continue to grow and learn. But the other end of that is also true. It's important for us to hang on to some of our dearest and deepest and most sacred and important traditions as well, because we've been handed those as a gift from those who have gone before us, even a gift, I believe, from God the Almighty. You know, I know some people who are resistant to learn new things, but I also know some folks who change their entire core belief system after watching an episode on the Discovery Channel, right? You know anybody like that? He said, "I believe this." Oh, wait a minute. An hour later, after watching some new TV show, they say, "Well, maybe I believe this. Maybe I believe that." My goodness. Sometimes we're so fickle in what we believe, it does not serve us very well at all. What does the Bible say about that? The book of James, and I really like James, because the ancient church believed that it was written by the brother of our Lord. And for me, that just makes it, I don't know, especially poignant. James chapter 1, verse 5 says this, "If any of you lacks wisdom, ask God, who gives to all generously and ungrudgingly, and it will be given to you. But ask in faith, never doubting. For one who doubts is like a wave of the sea, driven and tossed by the wind. For the doubter, being double-minded and unstable in every way, must not expect to receive anything from the Lord." Wow, that's strong. It's a strong word of guidance and warning from the Scriptures for us to be people of faith. Sometimes it's important to let the moment be silent, that the centuries may speak. New information and new knowledge is very, very important for us. What God might do in your life or my life this morning during the next half an hour is very important for us. But all of that comes in the context of how God has been working in our world and in humans' lives from the very beginning. It's important sometimes for us to let this moment, the newest and the greatest, be silent so the centuries of our tradition and our ancient faith can speak to us. The Apostles' Creed, I believe, is a tremendous gift. It's a tremendous gift handed on to us by Christians who've come before us. I believe inspired by God in the church. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth. Say it with me. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth. One more time. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven. Just saying it makes me feel good. I believe in heaven. Jesus said, "In my Father's house there are many rooms." Believe in God, believe also in me. "In my Father's house there are many rooms. If it were not so, would I have told you that I go and prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and take you to myself, that where I am, you may be also." That makes me feel good, doesn't it, you? You know, I have a burning question, an issue in my heart. I want to know how to get to heaven. That was the burning issue and question for John Wesley. That question fueled his spiritual life and the early Methodist revivals. He said, "I want to know how to get to heaven. I want to know how to land safely on that happy shore." The good news is that God has provided for you and for me a place with God, a place we call heaven, maker of heaven and earth. Hasn't God given us a wonderful place to live? My goodness, this earth is so full of its beauty and wonder. From the rocky coastland of Maine all the way to the desert of Arizona. I said that this morning and someone came up after service and said, "I just got back from Arizona." The Arizona desert around Sedona is indeed a beautiful and wonderful place. The Grand Canyon. We think about the forests of the northwest coast all the way to the beaches of Florida and all other places around the world. Think about this world that God has given to us. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth. O Lord my God, when I in awesome wonder, sing with me, consider all the worlds thy hands have made. I see the stars, I hear the rolling thunder, thy power throughout the universe displayed. Sing out. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. I believe in God the Father, maker of heaven and earth. Some say it's just a creed. You still have to have faith. Well, that's true, friends. Faith is important in every aspect of our lives and every aspect of Christianity. The book of Hebrews says this about faith in chapter 11, verse 6. It says, "Without faith, it is impossible to please God. For whoever would approach God must believe that He exists and that He rewards those who seek Him." My prayer is that we might have faith to believe. If you're struggling with your belief, let me give you an experiment. An experiment suggested to me by an English friend of mine, a man named David. David had us over to his home after a time worshiping in England on the sabbatical I was on, you know, back in April. He and his wife invited us very graciously to their home for dinner. And on the road going to his home, he told me his testimony. He said he'd grown up in the Church of England. In fact, he had an older brother who went on to be an English priest. And he was always expected to kind of live up, you know, to the example of his brother. And so that was tough for him. By the time he was a teenager, he was really questioning his faith. Wasn't so sure he wanted to be a Christian. Wasn't so sure he wanted to have anything to do with the church. And by the time he went to university, he decided he was an atheist. He just turned his back on all of that. But it didn't take him long to be miserable. And he said, "I can't live like that either. I'm not sure I believe, but I can't stand not to believe." And so he went to his brother, and his brother had this wise counsel. He said, "Try this. For 6 months, just put aside all your doubts and all the stuff you don't believe and live as if you do. Try that for 6 months and see what happens." It changed his life. And it changed his life forever. And he never looked back. He's been serving the Salisbury Church now for many years because of that great experiment. He said, "Just try it. Pretend like you do believe. And live your life fully as if you do for 6 months and just see what happens." My friend David, he never looked back. The Apostles' Creed is an important creed. It teaches us something important about our faith. Here's some takeaway points that I think are, for me anyway. The Apostles' Creed reminds us, "I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth." That means God is God and I am not. Right. That's important for me to remember that. As ludicrous as it sounds, sometimes I forget that. Sometimes I put myself in the driver's seat. Sometimes I begin to think it all depends on me. And I don't, you know, I forget who I am and I forget who God is. And some of you here this morning need to hear this word. As your pastor, let me give you a pastoral word this morning. If you feel like you've got the weight of the world on your shoulders right now, from something that's happened at work, something that's happened at home, some other issue or situation in your life, you don't have to carry the world on your shoulders. God already has it, okay? Say that with me. God already has it. You can let go of some of that burden today. It's not that God doesn't want us to do our part, but that's all we need to do. The rest of it, the future, how things play out, we can't control as much as we think we can, but we don't have to because God is God and we are not. God already has it, friends. You can let Him have it. Secondly, if God is our Father Almighty, we've got to remember that the rest of us are all brothers and sisters, and we're in the end accountable to Dad for what we do and how we treat each other. That's kind of the way, you know, in our best days, that's kind of the way it worked out in my house when I was growing up, right? I don't know if it worked out that way in your house or not, but we were accountable to Dad in the end for what we did and for how we treated one another. I know that some of us here probably didn't have great parental images, but God is like a good parent, a good father, a provider, a source of life, someone who guides us, someone who has our best interests in mind. And in the end, all of us as brothers and sisters are accountable to Dad for what we do and how we treat each other. And then finally, God is the creator of heaven and earth. What a majestic thing. God has created wonderful art for us to enjoy. All the earth is the handiwork of God, and great art demands great respect. You know, when you go into a museum and you're looking at those really beautiful paintings, maybe from some of the masters, You know, there's usually a docent not too far behind, making sure you don't reach out and touch it. I got in trouble in London because I got too close to one. I was just kind of eyeballing, taking my glasses off. And, you know, he came by. He was literally giving me the once over. Back up a little, sir, please. We know about you people from Oklahoma. And but, you know, great art demands, deserves great respect. My family and I are trying to do a better job with our recycling. There are some folks in our church that have a recycling business. There may be others too. I'd be happy to share that with you if you're not doing that yet, but that's one thing you can do. There's so many ways that we can respond to this good news. But friends, great art deserves great respect. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth. Say it with me. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth. Amen. If you're able, will you stand and let's have a prayer together. We thank you, God, for your love and for your grace and for your goodness. We thank you, Lord God, that you have the world and we don't have to worry about running it ourselves. Help us this morning, Lord, to release some of those burdens that we've been carrying around. We thank you too, Lord, that you are our Heavenly Father and that makes the rest of us brothers and sisters. So, Lord, help us to not only do what you've called us to do, but also help us to be careful with how we treat each other. Lord, thank you for this beautiful planet you've given us, all the worlds that you've created. Lord, help us to remember that great art deserves great respect. These things we pray and give you thanks. In Jesus' name, amen.